I want to talk a little bit about the basic ISIS terminology that we'll be working with and exactly what those mechanisms look like. The system's not very complicated, but it does have basic kinds of functionality that it's important to be comfortable with in order to make any sense of the documentation or the other MOOC modules. And the first and the most important of these constructs is what we call an ISIS process group. So what's an ISIS process group? It's a collection of programs which have bound themselves together, and the thing that they're sharing is a kind of a portal into a shared messaging infrastructure that lets them send each other messages, multicasts, point-to-point messages, secure information, and they use this to coordinate the management of data that each of the endpoint programs is managing independently on its own. If you watch the introduction module, I was describing the way that you might have private data in each program and then create a group and use the group to send updates to that private data. And then each of the different copies would update their own private data. And that's the idea here. So a group has a name. At any given point in time, it has a set of members, at least while it's active. It interacts with those members through events, and the events are delivered as upcalls. And there's a state, but the state that is associated with the group that you as the application developer care about is in objects that you build and that you work with. ISIS doesn't need to know about that state directly. It delivers multicasts and you apply them to the state. It asks you to make a checkpoint and you look at your state objects and then you write that data into the checkpoint. Okay, so in ISIS, the group object doesn't actually have any application state in it. Now, I want to talk a little bit about the notion of a join or create of a group. So when a program starts in ISIS, it's not actually in any groups at all, or actually a more honest and detailed answer would be, when you start ISIS up, your program joins two groups, but they're hidden system groups. One of them is called ISIS members, and it's a collection of every member of the system. And the other is called the ISIS Oracle group, and only some of the members of a system join that. The first 1 to 3, maybe 5, you can determine how many. And that number of members forms a second group called the Oracle, and it's used to keep track of the membership of other process groups. Okay, but aside from those two groups, your program doesn't belong to any groups at the moment you launch ISIS. And then you ask ISIS to set groups up, and then you join those groups when they've been set up. And the reason I'm making that distinction is because in ISIS, if you try to connect to a group but your application isn't configured properly, instead of letting you join, it throws an exception and says your application hasn't connected the correct handlers, and therefore it's not prepared properly. The call that you use to start ISIS up in this very early stage is called ISIS system start. And so you can see it here, ISIS system dot start. There's a case where you can pass an argument to it. And in that case, you can get a faster start if you wish. I talk about that a little bit in the configuration and runtime parameters module. So here's a new group being created. Group G equals new group. This one is going to be called my group. You can call it anything you like. And it creates a kind of an ISIS 2 object that'll be your portal for talking to the other members. And then what you're going to do is connect handlers to this. And only after that are we going to join G up with the other instances of this group. And so while we're working with the handlers, the group isn't live. It's not actually connected to anybody else. And we're going to be able to do any setup we want to do on it locally while it's in this kind of idle state. Right. Later, you're going to do a g.join operation or a g.create, and at that point, ISIS reaches out across the network and links this, and it suddenly becomes live. I use the term handlers. Handlers are small methods that you write that receive upcalls from ISIS, and so a handler might be used to tell you about the membership of a group changing. That would be a new view handler. It might be used to tell you about an event occurring, like the receipt of a multicast message, maybe an update that changes the group state. All right, and we do calls from ISIS into your code, and we say that we're calling a handler for that category of events. Every group member is expected to attach the same set of handlers to the group with one or two exceptions. Not everyone has to have the same set of view handlers, but that's sort of a special case. So view handlers sense membership changes. Message handlers process incoming messages. It turns out that all messages go to the message handlers, but there are two kinds of incoming messages, point-to-point messages and multicast messages. And we'll make that distinction more clear later, but in any case, the handlers are the same. They're the methods attached to the ISIS message handler's hook on this kind of a group G. And then there are checkpoint creation handlers. And then there are a couple of other cases you'll hear about elsewhere in the modules that we've recorded, such as aggregation and DHT collision handlers. Right? And after registering exactly the same set of handlers as everybody else, you can think of yourself as having a kind of a type signature associated with your version of the group. It's not just a group called my group, it's a group called my group that's able to handle multicasts that have a string and a double in them and queries that have a string in them. And that type signature can be checked against the signature of the other members of the group. All right. Another thing you can do at the time you're setting up the group is turn the group security features on, and a key might become associated with your endpoint that we can check against the key used by the others in a secure protocol that we've designed. And so in this sense, you're configuring the group before you join, and by the time you join, you need to be in the same compatible state as the others, but along the way, you can incrementally attach things. I use the term view. View is a data structure used in ISIS to characterize the membership of a group as it changes. So you can see in this picture, we've got process P creating the group, and that oval is the first view. It's a view that was perhaps the first view of the group, my group, or whatever it was called, and it only contained process P. Then there was a view containing Q and showing that Q had joined. A view with P, Q, R, S, T, and here there was a view with P and Q having left, because they failed apparently, and R, S, and T are the only members left. So a view has v.members is a list, an array of the members of the group. Each of the elements of that list is an address, and I'll explain what that is in a moment. A list of the joiners and leavers. It could be an empty zero-length array, but the array will be there no matter what. The view identifier, which increases monotonically, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Something called v.gname, which is a pointer to the group name, and something called the view offset. We're going to hear much more about the offset in a different module, but the idea is that state transfer to a joining member is done by creating a checkpoint and sending it. But if a group manages a very large state, and I think you should be thinking here about gigabytes, okay, so a group with hundreds of kbytes of state, don't worry about this at all. But if you have gigabytes, we often transfer the state outside of the group membership structure, something using something called the out-of-band transfer scheme. And in that situation, there's a question of how you tell the group how much state of the group you already have. And what you do is when you do a join, you can specify, I already have 20,000 bytes worth of state, or 20,000 updates worth of state. V.offset is where that gets reported to an existing member. That would be process P or Q up in our picture here. They might be told that R and S and T already have 20,000 updates worth of state, which they obtained through an out-of-band transfer. And in that way, the state transfer that's sent could be a very small one, which saves time at the moment of the join. Here's a view handler, and its job is to receive notifications when the view changes in ISIS. And it's called on a special thread that ISIS maintains, and it uses that single thread per group to report view handler events and also multicast events, which means that you don't have to worry about a multicast coming in while the view is changing or the view changing while you're processing a multicast. In fact, kind of have to worry about the opposite. These threads, these upcalls to you, had better not block, because if they do, your application kind of wedges. It can't deliver new views and multicasts because I use that thread to deliver them on. Anyhow, so this ISIS thread, which is running in the background, and there's a second one I should mention for point-to-point stuff, we have a different second thread. And it does run concurrently. However, it doesn't deliver views. And so these two threads are sitting in the background doing upcalls to you as events come in for them. So here's the view handler upcall, and this particular program changes the console title on the little window that you're running on Windows to have the group name, the address of this process, the number in this incremental numbering scheme of this view, and the rank of this process in the view. But by rank, what we mean is look for your own address in the list of members. The list of members in ISIS will be is rigid for the view. Every member sees the same view. And it's ordered by age. So the process that joined earliest, it was P in our example earlier, he'll have rank 0. Q would have rank 1. R, S, and T would be 2, 3, and 4. But the ordering on R, S, and T, because they joined simultaneously, might be kind of arbitrary. So the idea is the longer you've been in some sense, which view ID you joined in determines how low your rank is. The older you are, the lower your rank. I want to talk a little bit about this notion of an address. As I mentioned, the list of members of a group, list of addresses, and I showed you isis.getMyAddress, where this process was asking for its own address. So what an address is a small data structure maintained by ISIS that contains the IPv4 address of the machine on which ISIS is running. So your process is on some machine. Each different machine will have its own IPv4 address. If ISIS sees multiple IPv4 addresses for a single machine, it always uses the last of them in the list. It looks down the list and it takes the last one. That's useful because sometimes a machine has multiple networks attached to it, and we wouldn't want to sort of be confused or ambiguous about how we name a machine. And then it has the process ID of the process that's running ISIS. You can have many processes on one machine run ISIS. And then two port numbers, which are used for contacting it. One of them is used for point-to-point traffic, and one of them is used for acknowledgments. Actually, the system will create additional port numbers as it runs for multicast traffic, but that's not part of the address object. Groups also have addresses, and a group address does contain a multicast address. That would be an IPv4 multicast, an IPMC multicast address that we've calculated and that we're going to use for multicast for that group. And we try to be efficient about this, so if two groups have the same membership, they might actually share the same multicast address. But it's disambiguated within the ISIS group addressing scheme, so that if you actually take the ISIS address for a group and compare it with a different group, it will always be different, even if they're sharing an IP multicast address. Okay. Similarly, if you compare the addresses of two processes that are using ISIS, they'll always be different if they're different processes, even if they're on the same computer. All right. And you can print an address. It'll print just as the process ID by default, but there's a thing called A2 string verbose format, where it will print every one of these fields. So we've talked a little bit about the idea that the view is a list of addresses, and the idea then of a rank is that if you look up your address in the list, you get your rank, and there are some methods then to learn your address, and to simplify life, we'll look up your address in the rank in the membership view for you, and so v.getMyRank returns an integer 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, which tells you which ranked process you are. And we often treat member 0, rank 0, as a special process. We call that the leader in the group. And there are lots of situations where we need some process to play a special role. It'll always turn out to be the leader. He doesn't turn out to have a lot of computing to do, but sometimes the leader is in charge of deciding what order to put messages in, for example. Simple, low latency kinds of actions. So you can obtain the addresses of other processes by looking inside the group membership and looking for them, or they can tell you their address. So very often in my code, if I would like some process to talk to some other process, the sender process will simply include its own address as part of what it sends, and that can be useful for certain situations where you're treating different processes in different ways. I'm going to comment that there is a special case that you may become puzzled with later, and I just put a little comment about it on this slide. We're going to talk in a different module about the notion of a master-worker relationship where a large batch of machines or processes join ISIS simultaneously. And in order to avoid ISIS overwhelming the membership oracle, we use this master-worker structure which batches up the joins. And it turns out in that situation, you need the address of the master process before you've actually started the system. Now, I just told you that the way you typically get the address of a process is it just tells it to you, or you can look it up in the group membership, but there's no group yet. So how do you do it in that case? In that one case, we allow you to create an address which has the host of the master and a zero for the process ID. And in that particular situation, we will allow you to specify the master is on this machine and we'll track down the master for you. But that's the only situation where an address wouldn't be fully filled out with the process ID in it. So you can use an address to send a message directly to a process as long as you are in a group that that process belongs to. This is a security restriction. We don't want you to send messages to processes that you don't have a relationship with, because we wouldn't want you to be accidentally DDoSing some kind of a process, and we wouldn't want you to be able to send it a poison pill. So you need to be in a group with that process. You can use it for a query. You could send a message that has a reply back. You can use it to figure out rankings. And if a process were unresponsive, or if it sent you garbage and you realized there's something terribly wrong with it, you can even use the address of a process, if you're in a group with it, to tell ISIS that that process has failed. But you can never kill off a process or talk to a process if you don't share a relationship with it through a group. Let's talk a little bit about the notion of consistency, which is very important throughout the ISIS system. It's a central property, actually. Consistency is focused on the idea of guaranteeing that replicated information, whether that might be data in a group or actions the group are taking, are in a state which is essentially equivalent across the different members of the group. I don't want to say the same because of this notion of ranking. So I could have a group in which I've stored some amount of data. And if I did that, it might be that I decide to store some of the data at some members and other data at other members. Excuse me for a sec. That'll cut out. Some of the data at some members and other data at other members. And if I decided to do that, obviously they wouldn't have the identical states. Consistency has to do with whether all the members are following the same rules, and to the extent that the members should have the same replicated data, whether they do have the same replicated data, and when data changes, whether those change events are applied in the same order at all the members, essentially at the same time. This business of different members having different ranks can feel a little confusing until you get used to it, because it forces you to sort of visualize parallel code where everyone executes it, but different processes might do different things anyway. But once you get used to this idea, it's really very natural. So you can call getMyRank, and the rank always comes back as an integer between 0 and n minus 1, where the length of the membership list is the current value of n. So here's a simple thought problem you might think about. I've got a group here with three members, rank 0, 1, and 2. And the group has some sort of a view V, which would be the representation of 0, 1, and 2. And I've got this array of data with R rows. And what I'd like you to think about just for a second is, if we want each member to do equal work, what would be the best way to guarantee that? Okay, what I'm hoping you came up with is the idea that they might count off by rank, just as you would if a team of people in a Cub Scout group was going to, you know, chop wood or something. Who's going to do that? Well, everybody who counted off 0. So here's what we've done. We've numbered the rows, and then we've just taken it modulo the size of the group. And so you can see that the member with rank 0 will look at the row with Sally, Doug, and Helen. The member with rank 1 will look at the row with Sam and Mary and Harry, and so forth. So this is a good example of consistent behavior that isn't identical behavior. And I'm emphasizing that because too many people say consistency, oh, that just means they have the identical data. But you see, if you say something that quickly, you miss the possibility that the group might be changing, the system might be changing the data, and it might not even have stored the identical data at the same members. In fact, later we'll talk about sharding. And with sharding, it may be that Sally's data with Sally and Doug and Helen is stored at a different place, a different subset of the group members than the data for Sam and Barry and Harry, which might be on a different, what we call, shard. So you're going to need to get used to this idea that replication doesn't always mean identical, lockstep, perfect replication. In ISIS, the bigger picture is a notion of consistency, where if in fact you wanted identical lockstep replication, no problem, it's easy to do. But if you wanted slightly different behavior for the different members of your group, that would actually easily be doable as well. And you can use the group view in order to achieve that. So where did the value n come from here? Well, it came by reading it out of group v and saying v.members.length, that's how many members are in the group right now. That's the length of the array. It's 3 in this particular case. v.members.getMyRank, hey, my rank is 1. I'm responsible for rows that are modulo 1 if I modulus it against v.members.length, which is the number of members in the group right now. You see? Sometimes we do a query where different members perform different work, and then they aggregate the results. And you want the aggregated result to reflect exactly one contribution for each piece of data. Now, it's interesting to understand that consistency has many manifestations in ISIS. When you request something from a group, all the members will be in the same view of the group. And that's very useful because it says that when they decide who does what, they decide it on the basis of equivalent data. Another thing that you're able to do is to handle failures in a coordinated way. You can say, I should have gotten 5 answers from this group, but I only got 3. So apparently 2 of the members who should have answered my query crashed before they answered. That could well have happened in this example that I've got here, because as you can see, P and Q crash after receiving some kind of a multicast, which could have been a query, and it's quite possible they didn't get a chance to answer the query. And in ISIS, you're able to tell how many answers you should have gotten, how many answers you did get. You know that every member received the request in the same state, or at least in a consistent state. And these guarantees go a long way towards making it very easy to build sophisticated distributed behaviors. So with the case of queries that send replies, how do you do that? And the answer is sort of dumb. It's one of those dough kind of things. You have the members tell you how many members were in the view. Now, they're all going to tell you the same thing. Every one of them is going to say, there were 5 members when I sent this reply. You don't really need to look at all of those answers to know that they'll be the same. But from any one of them, you can check and see, did I get 5 answers? And if you got back 3, but they all said you should have gotten back 5, you know you're missing 1. And they can tell you what their rank was, so you know that you got 5 answers from rank 0, 1, 3, 2, and 5, and 4. And then you can create an array, or you can merge the data together, and that's the aggregating step I mentioned before. And if you didn't get the right number of answers, well, failures do happen in distributed systems. We're giving you the power to notice that the failure happened, and then you can decide what you wish to do about it. All right. And in fact, one answer is to just handle failures by sending the same data redundantly and have the aggregator get rid of the duplicates, but at least you get 2 copies of the same answer or 3 copies of the same answer. And you can throw away the dupes, but you're tolerant of 1 or 2 failures, you see? So in this particular case, perhaps I've got a reply which involves a primary and a secondary version of the answer, but probably the versions will be the same. And the value of doing something like this would be, instead of having to reissue your query, if it was kind of an expensive query to calculate and you don't really want to reissue it, well, you made people do a little extra parallel work, but you got back a duplicated answer. And in the event of a failure, you still got back an answer. Consistency tells you that you don't even need to check that the answers are the same. They will be the same. In ISIS, that kind of a mistake won't happen unless your program has a bug. So here we got one reply that contains 2 answers, and then we would throw away the redundant replies. In a large enough group, you can start to get even fancier and talk about having primary repliers, secondary repliers, and even members that are non-repliers. And all these different kinds of options that you might dream up on a whiteboard are very easy to implement in ISIS because the strong consistency properties of the system correspond to make it easy to have different members of the group see the same request and reach different kinds of conclusions, perform different kinds of actions at essentially the same time, the same logical time. When we talk about sharded data, we'll be using that feature quite heavily. So let's look at a message handler. That's another case of a handler. So you'll see what we've got here. First of all, that the group has a vector of these handlers. And the reason for that is that in many kinds of applications, we'd like to break the requests into categories, like update category, maybe a lookup category. There might be a kind of parameter setting control category. There could be a debugging category in handlers. And so the intent here is that this small integer, you're seeing two in this example, represents the category of handlers. And then each handler has a method associated with it. And you can write that as a piece of code, just like a standard method, and put it here. So it could have said mygroup.handlers of two plus equals myUpdateHandler. I tend to like code that has an inline style. And so I use what C# calls an anonymous delegate for these purposes. And you can see this notation. First, you have the type of the delegate. An action is just the C# fancy keyword for a method. There's another for functions, which is more appropriately named. That one just says function. But this is a void function. It's a method. And the string is telling us that this takes a single argument, which is of type string. If there were two arguments, you'll sometimes see an action string comma int, for example. If there were no arguments, it would just say action curly angle brace angle brace. So that's a type, and I'm casting this thing called a delegate, which is a special built-in keyword in C# that says I didn't feel like giving this function a name. And here's the code for the method. It has an argument of type string called name. And what it does is it sends a reply. This particular method is apparently one that handles queries. Okay? And it handles queries by sending back the number of members in the recurrent view, which, if you remember, we're recommending you do in order to make sure you got something from everybody, the rank of this process, and then it responds with something it's calling its share of the answer, which is probably whatever it computed by looking at its rows in the database or its share of the data, whatever that might have been. So this handler will get invoked when a query is issued that indicates handler number two, code number two, and that has a string as its argument. All right? And they have to match up. So we're polymorphic, but when you do a query or you do a multicast in ISIS, we're going to check that there is a handler that will be able to handle that request. And we will throw an exception if you try to take an action which doesn't match up. So each handler has a request code. It's a small integer. It has a type signature, which relates to the arguments it takes. And an incoming message must match a handler, and we won't even send the message if it's not going to match it. That way, we throw the exception in the sender, not inside the group, which again avoids a kind of poison pill behavior. So what is this delegate? And again, a delegate in C# is a special kind of a keyword that you use when you don't feel like giving a name to a method or a function that you'd like to define in a block of code that's right in line. Okay, and so our delegate there, you do give the arguments and their types, but you didn't bother to name it query handler number four or whatever it would have been. It's mostly to save having to figure out separate names for things which really don't have meaningful names anyway. Now, telling ISIS about a type is important. You've seen me use a query here that had a string type, but what if you wanted to send something a type called a foobar? Something of your very own. Well, you're going to define an object type called a class called foobar, and you're going to instantiate it. But how do you tell ISIS how to send someone a foobar and how to reconstruct one when it comes in? For that, what you're going to do is you're going to annotate your class, and I want to show you how to do it. And then you're going to need to register this class with ISIS so that it understands that foobars can be put in messages and extracted from them. So you do it this way. Your type is going to need a code very similar to handlers, but it's a different numbering system, but it's still from 0 to 127. And the code here is going to be used in the register type call, which I've got at the bottom on the right, message.register type, type of my data. The zero here, that's the example of the code. As you write your program, you're going to be numbering 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So if you had 25 types, you'll be using 0 through 24. Okay. Up above, you can see an example of an annotated class. And what you can see in this class is it starts with the square brace auto-marshaled. This is telling ISIS that you would like ISIS to put the public data fields in any outgoing message that will contain an object of class MyData. And you can see there's one public data field here. It's the variable named D. There could be many. And if there were private data fields or internal data fields or other types of restricted access data fields, ISIS will skip those. So the public data is what's going to be sent, and the public data will be received. Now, in order to use auto-marshalling, you do need to give ISIS a way to initialize an instance of one of these classes. And so you do that by providing a constructor that has no arguments. And what will happen is, if ISIS receives a MyData object from some other node, it's going to create a new MyData using the null constructor. So you can initialize fields if you like to at that point. Then it's going to reach into the public fields and fill them with the data it extracted from the MyData object on the sending side. And on the sending side, what it does is it walks down the list of data items and it says, oh, this is an integer, that's a double, and that's how it creates the marshaled object. It's very common that you would want to override the toString method in any kind of an object you were telling ISIS about. That way, if an error occurs, or if you're using the debugger, you'll be able to actually understand the contents of the received object. Visual Studio, at least, as a debugger, will automatically know that it should use that method to print one of these things if you ask it what value it has. It can be very useful when you're trying to make sense of bugs. So user-defined types, don't forget to register the type, but if you do, if ISIS sees you trying to send a MyData object but it's never been registered, it'll print an error message, it'll throw an exception actually, and that error message associated with the exception is going to be, did you forget to register one of your types? And the answer would have been yes in that case. You can define classes in which only some fields are marshaled, and in fact, you can provide your own marshaling. Instead of using auto-marshaling, if you prefer, you can write a method called toBArray in which you generate the marshaled representation. And the message object class in ISIS itself has a method which will take vectors of objects and turn them into byte arrays, and take byte arrays and turn them back into vectors of objects, which you can use if you like. It's really quite a concise representation. It's better than what C-sharp will do with C-sharp serialization. But you can use C-sharp serialization. Another concept to understand about ISIS is what we call state transfer. And I showed you a state transfer earlier. This relates to the idea that when members join a group, we have to initialize the local variables that the member is going to have associated with the group. So typically you joined a group because you want to coordinate in some way, and very often there's data associated with that. So state transfer is how you get the current values of that data from the existing members into a joining member. Okay, and you're going to need to do this by registering a checkpoint making method and a checkpoint loading method. It's very much like method handlers for messages and views. So you can see here, g.makeCheckpoint is going to send actually two checkpoints that one of them has an integer in it and one has a double. And then what's going to happen is on the receiving side, the integer load checkpoint delegate will get invoked when the integer shows up, and the double one will get invoked when the double shows up. I would not recommend using two calls for such small things, because you could have said send checkpoint with a whole list of things, and it can have all sorts of stuff in it. All right, but you would want to call send checkpoint multiple times if you were going through a complicated structure, or if the objects would just get too big if you tried to do a single call. ISIS doesn't do so well on really big things. However, I will mention that there's a separate module in which we talk about the out-of-band transfer scheme, and that can handle very big objects quite efficiently. You just don't want to send them internal to ISIS, which would be what would happen here. So this is a checkpoint method, and these checkpoints are used for several purposes. You can make a group state persistent, by calling GDOT persistent and specifying a file name into which the group state can be checkpointed. And in that case, every time the view changes, or any time you would like us to make a checkpoint, we'll create one and store it into that file. And later, if the group restarts from scratch, we'll reload what was in that file. We also use send checkpoint for state transfers. And so what happens there is that as a member joins, we call this the make checkpoint routine in the existing group members. In fact, what we do is we call it typically in the zero ranked member, the leader I mentioned earlier. But if you'd prefer that we call it in someone else, you can actually set something called the set point chooser. You can attach a method which for a particular joining member will tell you which existing member will generate a checkpoint for that member. And in that case, we'll do as you asked us to. Okay, and you can have that then be any member of your group. But do be careful. If a crash occurs while sending a checkpoint, that's not recoverable. What happens is that the sender crashes, but also the joining member gets killed. We don't have a fault tolerance mechanism for state transfer into a joining member. So that one step has to occur successfully. It's a good idea to consider pre-transferring the checkpoint data if it's going to be large, by which I would mean more than a couple of megabytes, and probably even if it's as small as, say, 500 kbytes, it might be beneficial to do this. Certainly, though, if it gets to many megabytes. And what you do then is you use the out-of-band transfer mechanism, and then use, at the time of the join, you have to specify how much state you've actually received. And you can arrange for a checkpoint that's made for the state transfer, which only includes the delta. It turns out in order to do that, you're going to need to talk to the members of the group to ask them to send you the out-of-band transfer. And for this, we have a thing called isis.client, which is a little bit like being a group. But instead of being a member of the group, it makes you it gives you permission to access a representative of the group, and that representative of the group has to authorize that clients of the group are allowed to call a certain, and this is for security purposes. So what will happen is that the members of the group will say that they're going to allow client requests to handler zero. And then it could be handlers five, whatever category you prefer. And then when you use g.client, you can access those handlers. And if you send in a type matched request, it'll be sent to one representative of the group. It'll be picked randomly for you. And then that representative can do things on your behalf, such as sending you this out-of-band state transfer to pre-initialize you. Unicast is the converse of multicast. So multicast is when we talk to all the members of the group. ISIS also allows you to talk to individual members of the group. And you do that by specifying the address that you would like to talk to within the group. And then you'll be doing a point-to-point send, or you might be doing a point-to-point query, and the query, of course, will give you a response. So here's a point-to-point send. You specify the address of your target, after which you've got the same as usual, the request code, which has to match some handler, and arguments, which had better be of the same type. And if it was a point-to-point query, it would look the same, but then you would say end of list, which is the way that we mark the end of the arguments to the query part and the beginning of the places to put the results. And then there would be a series of result lists, one for each type of result that you might get. And they have to match up. So here's the query. And you can see exactly that destination, the request code, and the arguments. End of list. And so that's an end of list marker object that you instantiated. You really only have to do that once in a given program. And then a list of P2P result places to put them, which will each will be lists. And they have to match the types used in the reply. And the EOL marker is just a special type that ISIS uses to know when the arguments ended and when the result lists start. And a multicast is a way to talk to all the members of the group, and ISIS has a notion of scheduling the multicast at a time when it temporarily locks down the view. You don't even see this happen, and it will send to all the members in the view at the time it decides to deliver it, and they will all get that multicast, or nobody will get it. All right? And one case where nobody gets it is if the sender initiates the multicast but then crashes. ISIS either delivers the multicast before it reports the failure, or it will not perform a multicast. In fact, ISIS never allows a multicast from the dead. So if a multicast is initiated after somebody has been dropped from a group for whatever reason, or after we've detected their failure, we won't deliver that multicast. So here's a multicast. It's a send. It has a request code and a list of arguments, and again, they have to match the types. Query, similar idea, starts with a multicast, but now it has a place to put the results. And so that's queue results here, and the queue results will be a list, and the number of things you'll find in that list will be the same as the this value that came back from the query, nr, which is a small integer. And so if, for example, you asked for n results and only got back three of them, nr will be three, but n might be a bigger number. And in fact, you can specify that you would like answers from all the members of the group, because in general, when you do the query, you don't know how many members will be in the group. And so we can do that by just specifying all as a constant. All has a special value that ISIS recognizes, and at the moment it decides to schedule the multicast, it switches all to be the correct value of n for that view. At that point, you're doing a query which is waiting for seven results, because there were seven members, or three results. And at the time that you get back the answer, it'll always be zero through the number you asked for. But it might be smaller than the number you asked for, because members could fail, or they could just not reply. And it's automatic in ISIS that if a member is supposed to reply to a query but doesn't, ISIS will send back what's called a null reply, which says, this guy just didn't choose to send one. I don't know why. There is a way to say I'm forking off a thread and the thread will send the reply, but if you don't use that feature, then ISIS will generate a null reply unless you generate a reply. There's a notion of a timeout associated with queries. So you can build a little timeout data structure, and you give an amount of time that you're willing to wait for replies, and then what should happen if we're still missing some? And you can see here are the three cases. You can say after, in this case, 2 seconds, you specify TO abort, that will say the query throws an abort exception. If you say TO failure, that will say if anybody hasn't replied after 2 seconds, consider them to have crashed. And ISIS really will consider them to have crashed. They will be thrown out of the system, and they will probably exit. They'll throw an exception that they got poisoned. That's a pretty strong thing to do, and I wouldn't do it after just 2 seconds, at least not if you're working in the cloud. And TO null reply simply says, if somebody is slow after 2 seconds, give me back as many answers as I've got. Okay. So ISIS considers the process to have failed in the following situations. First of all, you can override these, and I'll explain how. But one answer is, if ISIS itself is waiting for something called ISIS timeout seconds, then ISIS will consider that the process failed. So ISIS has a default 45-second wait. It's willing to wait that long and no longer for its internal protocols. But that's a large number, and you might be saying, why so large? And the answer is that on the platforms we run on, we often see many seconds of delay when we do internal protocols that involve queries of other nodes. It seems to be a characteristic of the cloud that sometimes these virtual machines that the cloud is running get so overloaded that they basically are thrashing, and you can see delays of 15 or 20 seconds very commonly. And so we set the timeout default to be 45 seconds. And even then, it can take two of those timeouts in certain circumstances before a fault is reported. So the default ISIS failure handler is actually going to take as many as 90 seconds. You could set that to a much smaller number, but beware that the more aggressive you set it, the more likely you are to have a false detection. You can also tell ISIS that a process has failed, and there are some situations where that's very convenient to do. You might build a script or something that notices, or you could have a parent process that spawns a child process, and if the child process crashes, the parent reports the failure. Or perhaps some query returns an answer that's total nonsense. You threw an exception because of that guy. You could say that guy failed. You have to be in the same group, though. We won't let you call ISIS process failed on a process which isn't related to you through some kind of group relationship. And finally, and this is probably the best one to know about, if an application is running with ISIS but it's going to exit, don't just unilaterally exit. First call ISIS.shutdown. And if you do that, your exiting process notifies everyone else instantly. I'm out of here. And within milliseconds, they will have dropped it out of any groups that they're in. The payoff of that is that your system is operating in real time and reconfiguring, because if your process had just terminated, that would look like a failure and you'd be in this 45-second delay case, which presumably you don't really want to be in. Now, I want to talk a little about threads. I'm sure you know what a thread is. Most systems use threads. ISIS uses them quite heavily. So how do threads work? Well, C# makes it very easy to create threads. There's a thread.new. You basically say thread t equals new thread. You can have a delegate right there, which I often do. And then you say t.start, thread is running. And you can give the thread a name, t.name equals, and I do that actually. And so my threads have sensible names, but they're sensible to me. ISIS has tons and tons of threads. Unfortunately, I'll comment, sometimes mistakes you make cause exceptions in my threads. If ISIS crashes by throwing an exception, the very first thing to ask yourself is it your fault as opposed to my fault? It might be my fault. There are bugs in the system. But after 3 years of debugging it and hardening it, it's not very common anymore. Much more often, somebody will show me something which has thrown an exception, and they'll say, there's a bug in ISIS. It must be in your code because it's in your thread. And I'll go and look, and I'll discover that you gave me a vector of objects, and the fourth object was a null pointer. Right? And things like that can cause my code to throw an exception, but very often it's your code that was wrong. Okay, so ISIS does make a lot of use of threads. You're going to typically find that there are about 8 system threads running. They spend a lot of their time sleeping. They almost never do any real computing. So the fact that there are a lot of threads doesn't mean that ISIS is slow. These are threads that are there in order to respond instantly if a message arrives. So their real purpose in life is to be asleep up until the microsecond when a message is available, and then to start processing it without any delay. On Windows, this isn't necessarily the best way to do things, but on Linux it is. And because I want to run on both settings, I spawn threads. You're also going to see that there are the two threads I mentioned earlier, a point-to-point message event delivery thread running, and a multicast event delivery thread running. And if you have multiple groups, there'll be two such threads per group. One implication of this, by the way, is that if the view handler or the multicast handler blocks for some reason, ISIS will not deliver additional messages to that group. It'll just pile up messages down in the system, waiting until the thread allows it to do more up calls to do delivery. So if you're going to do something that might block or run for minutes, spawn a thread of your own and do it over there in that thread. And if you then have to do a reply to a query, just look it up in the manual. There's a way to tell us that a different thread will be doing the reply on behalf of this query, and we can handle that. Okay. We also create a few more threads from time to time, and we create some threads if we're using hardware multicast, which we often do, to watch for messages to come in and go out. Now, you might think with 16 or 18 threads, you should allocate a lot of cores to ISIS. Not true. It turns out the very best performance in ISIS is typically with one core. One core and 16 threads. You can think to yourself, why would that be? And the answer is that with one core, you don't get a lot of lock contention and memory contention in the subsystems that do that. But with many cores, the many cores spread over ISIS, and yet these ISIS threads aren't really doing much of anything. And you end up just slowing down the hardware subsystem. The only time you'll benefit from allocating even more than one core to ISIS would be if you spawn threads and they do a fair amount of computing. Then perhaps there's a benefit to having two cores assigned to your app. Now, because of this notion of threading, it's important to understand how ISIS thinks of the world. When you launch ISIS, you're going to call ISIS system start. I showed you that earlier, and that's going to start the ISIS system up. Well, what should it keep doing? Should it, for example, run forever? The way we handle this is we say, well, ISIS system is going to watch the main thread. And if it sees the main thread exit, the ISIS system is also going to gracefully exit and shut down. In fact, in that case, we call ISIS shutdown for you, and you don't even need to do it. And we send that multicast that notifies everybody. So the main thread exiting, oddly enough, is a good way to exit. Environment that terminate would be a terrible way to exit from our point of view. That's the case where the process just evaporates suddenly. Where in Linux, exit, that's not such a great thing to call. Now, if your main thread exiting is going to cause ISIS to shut down, well, that may not be quite what you wanted. Suppose you're building a server, you set up ISIS, and now the server is going to be event-driven by things coming in from the outside. Well, how's that supposed to work? The answer we've got for that is that your main thread probably doesn't want to terminate. And so what you can do is you can call isis_system.waitforever in your main thread. And that will mean that your main thread sets up ISIS, builds the groups, joins the groups, and then it pauses at that point, and it'll sit there until an ISIS shutdown occurs. And that way, your process won't exit. The little console window won't close. You can print error messages to it. Of course, if you don't have a console window, that's irrelevant to you. But the point being that in this way, you maintain an active address space within which ISIS is watching for incoming messages and processing them and sending messages. And so this is a very, very common model to see. Someone starts ISIS up, and then eventually they call wait forever. You don't have to use the ISIS wait forever, though. If you're using a graphics package, you could also use the GUI package main loop. That'll work just as well. Just don't have the thread that called ISIS exit unless you want ISIS itself to shut down. Okay? I want to talk a little more about being a client of a group briefly. So we talked about how to join a group and how to attach initializers to it, and then you call join. Well, with a client of a group, you don't actually join a group, but you can still talk to its members if they are willing to permit you to do that. So the way this is going to work is that you're not going to be a member, so you're going to instead be bound to some member by a load balancing trick that's built into ISIS itself. This is something you do as an ISIS application, but you don't feel like joining the group or you don't have the permissions to do it. You're allowed to issue unicast requests to your representative, and only unicast requests. So it's all P2P. And they have to allow client requests for the request code that your point-to-point query or message is using. Otherwise, your point-to-point request throws an exception. So the typical picture would be the group members set themselves up and they authorize client access on some request code, which they probably dedicate for clients and they don't use internal to the group. They're paranoid about those request codes because they're coming from non-members of the group. There are security issues with that. So they're going to be pretty careful to check for garbage and the sort of garbage in, garbage out, whereas they may be more trusting of each other on the regular group membership requests because those are by members who have been authorized properly, have the correct security key, and so forth. So now these requests come in from the clients, and once you've said allow client requests on a request code, the clients are able to call, become a client, and then call the point-to-point sends or the point-to-point queries using that request code. And then later, a client could actually join the group. In fact, sometimes you see this. I mentioned it earlier. You might want to become a client, request an out-of-band state transfer, receive it. Then you can dispose of your client handle and join the group. Okay? That works perfectly well. So there are these two system groups. Let me just quickly tell you what they do. One is called the Oracle group, and you may see threads associated with it. That's used to track the membership of other groups. It typically has between one and three or five members. ISIS has two modes of configuration. With one member, ISIS itself will crash if the Oracle member crashes. And who's the Oracle? It'll be whoever gets launched first and starts up ISIS. With three or four or five members, in those situations, ISIS has the ability to ride out failures even of the Oracle membership group, as long as the whole group doesn't fail. And in fact, the real rule is any individual failure can't split that group. If it does split the group, the majority piece will keep running, the minority piece will shut down. So for example, if ISIS experienced a partitioning and it used to have five members in the Oracle group, but now there's three over here and two over there, these two will exit and say a partitioning failure occurred, and all of ISIS will shut down on that side. And on this side of the partition, it'll just keep running. But with very small Oracle groups, like one member, you just don't have partition tolerance and the system will just keep running. Okay? And you can read in the manual about how we handle the case where we had two members and one fails. ISIS members is a special group that ISIS itself uses to track various statistics, and it includes every member who joins this particular version of the ISIS system. And we use it in a variety of ways. Out-of-band transfers make use of that. All sorts of indirection mechanisms use it. But you're not supposed to use ISIS members. We actually make it quite hard for you to get to the view of that group. So what I want to do now is end this module, and I'm going to do a little bit of a demo of how to use ISIS. We'll start with a couple more slides. I'll show you what I'm going to build. Then I'll run Visual Studio. I'm a Windows developer myself. But if you prefer Mono, you could do exactly the same things with the Mono developer. And then we'll come back with a couple more slides and look at what we could have done with that group and understand how it behaved.